Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Robotics Colloquium. It's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Brenna Argall from Northwestern University. Brenna is part of the Shirley Ryan Ability Lab there. It's one of the top rehab hospitals in the US. And her work there focuses on assistive and rehab robotics. Brenna got her PhD from CMU with Manuela Veloso and did a postdoc at EPFL with Aude Billard. And I actually met Brenna while we were both grad students. She's a little bit more senior to me. But she was, she's the first author of this very famous survey on learning from demonstration, which was my area of research. And I read this paper like many, many times. She's been very inspiring, great mentor. And more recently, with myself moving more into assistive robotics, I've been reading a bunch of her work, and I'm really excited to hear about it today. Before I give the floor for questions, please feel free to write them down in the chat along during the talk. Patricia is going to monitor, and then we can read these questions at the end, but also feel free to raise your hand at the end and ask questions. All right.
Thanks so much, Maya, for such a gracious introduction. It's been great to have you as a colleague for so many years and really great to be invited to give this talk. So thank you all. So as Maya mentioned, my lab is in the Shirley Ryan Ability Lab, which was formerly known as the Rehabilitation Institute of Chicago. So this is a rehab hospital that's located in downtown Chicago, and my lab, it's open plan. So my lab is actually embedded within a clinical space where specifically inpatients are receiving lower limb therapy. And the advantage that this gives us, or the real insight as engineers, is this clinical closeness and this ability to sort of marinate within the environment and get an idea of what the problem priorities are, and also have really ready access to clinical expertise and patient populations to evaluate our work. So we're quite lucky to be situated in this way. So in my lab, we focus on functionally assistive machines. And throughout the field, there is a pervasive challenge in how to capture control signals from the human body in order to operate these machines. So we see it with upper limb prostheses, where an array of EMGs captures electrical signals from the muscles that are meant to preserve the neural pathway in order to control the prosthetic limb the same way that we would control a human limb. And yet we have this confound where the higher the level of amputation, the fewer residual muscles that exist in order to actually capture signals from, and yet the more degrees of freedom that need to be controlled, the more complex the machine. We see this even with a powered wheelchair, which is arguably the most ubiquitous assistive machine and perhaps the most simple to control. It's just a 2D controlled problem. It's heading and speed. And yet for people who have upper limb motor impairments, the interfaces that might be accessible to them move down from being 2D continuous valued proportional control interfaces like a wheelchair to being 1D or what's called a 1.5D, where you sometimes can activate both at the same time, and being switches that just get turned on and off. So they're no longer proportional. If you issue a bigger signal, it doesn't actually result in a larger magnitude signal being issued to the or being transferred to the machine. And of course, this only becomes all the more complex as we consider assistive machines that are themselves more complex to control and have them be operated by users who only have access to these interfaces on the right. So just to recap, some of the challenges of assistive machine operation. So we have human impairment, where the human is actually, their impairment is actually masking and filtering the information that they would like to provide to the machine to control it. We have control interface limitations, especially for limited interfaces that are available to those with severe motor impairments. And these limitations come in the form of dimensionality and continuity of the right resulting signal. And we have machine complexity. And in particular, we have this catch-22, where oftentimes the more limited a person's mobility, the more complex it is, the assistance that they require. And yet that also means the machine is more complex to control. And so they need to issue a more complex signal in order to control it. So of course, a solution to this or that might help this is to add robotics autonomy to these machines. So if we add on sensors able to perceive the external world and some intelligence able to reason about those sensors and also the information we're getting from the human through whatever interface they're using to operate the machine, then we can make the machine partially able to control itself, turn it into an assistive robot, and ideally offload some burden from the user or increase access for people who aren't able to operate their machines or be prescribed a powered wheelchair, for example. So if we look at the space of rehabilitation robotics as a whole, I like to think of rehabilitation robots as existing in these two broad categories. So the first are rehab robots that aim to rehabilitate the human body. So these typically are exoskeletons or manipulandums, and they guide the human body through certain motions. They perhaps challenge the body, they take measurements, and the goal is to amplify rehabilitation or amplify physical therapy for the purpose of rehabilitating the human body. The second category of robots are robots that aim to replace lost function. So perhaps rehabilitation has plateaued and there remains a gap in function. And the idea is to use a robot or use an assistive machine to help bridge that gap. And when we think about adding autonomy to rehabilitation robots, it's typically in this category. So it's autonomy that provides functional assistance. So I will say that there are assist as needed controllers on the side of rehabilitating the human body that start to take respond to sensor measurements in a way where it starts to look like autonomy, but not in a functional way. So when we're replacing lost function, then whether or not it's feasible to add on autonomy depends a lot on the form factor of the machine. And in particular, if it's worn on the human body and if it's hanging off of the human body, then adding on sensors and computation and battery power is perhaps not practical. So this is very much the case for upper limb prostheses, where everything is actually hanging off of the arm through a socket connection, some sort of a socket connection that already is a big issue to get right, even when you aren't adding on additional weight to the machine. Heat is an issue. And so that adding on autonomy isn't immediate that you can just take what works on robotic arms and just put it on a prosthetic limb and you've solved the problem. If the assistive machine or the robot is not worn on the human body, now we have more options because we can mount some of those sensors or mount some of that computation, the computational hardware or the battery power onto whatever is supporting the robot itself. And this is where we see most academic work, most research on the topic of adding autonomy to assistive machines happening within this space. Okay. So when we add on autonomy to these assistive machines, the devil is really in the details in how we do this or how we achieve this intelligence. And the reason why is because if the autonomy steps in at the wrong time or with the wrong control signal or in response to the wrong signal coming from the environment or coming from the human, it actually takes away the human's autonomy. So if the human wanted to be in control and the robot takes over control, we're achieving the opposite of what we set out to achieve. So my lab's been working in this space for quite some time on this question of how to actually allocate control between humans and assistive machines. And an early study that we did, or a study we did a couple of years ago, was the first that actually side-by-side compared on actual hardware using actual autonomy paradigms, different wheelchair control paradigms that came from the literature. So there's no accepted way on what's the right way to share control. So we implemented each of these and we did a study. And what you might notice from these videos is that they don't appear to perform that differently. And that's actually what we saw in the data as well. So we saw that they were very similar in performance. There was no statistically significant differences between these five paradigms. One was direct teleoperation in terms of the typical measures that we use to evaluate robots like collision, number of collisions, execution time. But there were differences in user preference. So each paradigm was selected once, at least once as most preferred and at least once as least preferred. And this preference switched about 50% of the time when the interface switched. So we performed this study over actually 2 to 4 sessions. The reason why it wasn't always 2 sessions was because some of our spinal cord injured participants had sitting tolerances that required us to break some of their sessions in half. And so it was over 2 to 4 sessions. And so in this given session, they were operating one interface for the whole time. And about 50% of the time it switched with the interface and about 50% of the time it switched with the session, even when it was the same interface that had been broken in between multiple sessions. So what this was telling us is that we really need to think about customization and not about a one size fits all solution when we are designing autonomy assistance within this domain. But the fact that we saw a switch about 50% of the time when we across sessions, I think speaks to a larger issue within the field. So all of these challenges that I mentioned before, when a human is trying to operate a system, an assistive machine, is also a challenge for autonomy that's trying to step in and help with the assistive and provide assistance as well. And one thing that I think is very missing from this domain are longitudinal real world evaluations. So the majority of the work in this domain does a single study session, maybe a couple, like the one I just presented was a couple more than one, but not so much so. And you know, what we're really evaluating is novel interaction with these autonomy paradigms. And I think it's really difficult to draw any broad conclusions about human interaction with these autonomy paradigms when we're only evaluating novel interaction. So having said that, I'm actually going to take a step back. And I've already chatted with some people about this. This is a new presentation for me. So interface awareness is something that we've been slowly talking about more and more in my lab. And we've come to realize that we actually have a growing body of evidence in our research over the past couple of years that is speaking to the importance of being interface aware in our autonomy paradigms. So what I mean by that is that on the side of the robot control system, a velocity command received from the human will actually be treated differently if it derives from a joystick versus a sip and puff, for example. And so I'm going to hopefully try to make the case right now to convince you or to make a case for interface aware autonomy and convince all of you that it is important as well. So when this first started to come up was that we were doing a large characterization study. So this was, we were characterizing wheelchair operation, teleoperation by people with and without motor impairments performing seven tasks. So you can see on the right here, this is actually lab space that we have in the hospital where we've come up with these sort of simulated, but it's a sort of obstacle course where we've recreated a lot of environments or aspects of an environment that are challenging, that can be challenging for wheelchairs to navigate because of various constraints on position. And so we were performing this characterization study. We had seven tasks. We were doing three interfaces, one in each session. So we were doing a head array and a sip and puff and a joystick. And we were at the beginning of each session, we were collecting a clinical or three baselines. So we had a clinical standard, and then we also had two baselines of interface usage. And so what we see here is this command following task and the trajectory following tasks. These were the interface usage baselines that we were getting. And what we were trying to get a feel for was people's ability to operate the interface, what it looks like when they interact with the interface. And we wanted to take away the confound of actually operating hardware in the real world. So we came up with this command following task where it was that you just try to reproduce a target that's presented on the screen, and then also a trajectory following task where it was a very simple representation of the footprint of the 2D wheelchair. You had a direction prompt and you were trying to stay within the bounds of this path, going either forwards or backwards, depending on the direction prompt. And so what we found was actually that just in this baseline data, we had quite a bit of information. So in particular, for the command following task, we saw that actually all of these interfaces were equally able, or at least not significantly different in their ability to achieve task success. So this is an ability to produce the target command. We did see differences between the subject groups, but we did not see it in between the interfaces. But we saw a very large difference in terms of response time. So this was if you were going to be able to issue the correct signal, how long did it take you to issue it for the first time? An interesting thing we were also able to look at was that because the spinal cord injured participants were all wheelchair drivers, they all were experts in one interface, one of these interfaces. And so we could actually compare expert versus novice performance on this task, where the expertise in novice refers to the interface that's being used. And we again saw no significant difference in success, but we did in response time, which tells us also that there's customization that could be happening here, or awareness that could be happening here in terms of the form factor of the interface, but also in terms of the individual person. And we saw similar things in terms of settling time. So settling time is that when a person was able to issue the correct command, how long did, if their command was wavering around, how long did it take to actually settle to the final, to the resulting correct command from the point when they first issued the correct command. And we saw differences, significant differences all over the place in this regard. So why this matters for assistive autonomy is because we actually use the control signal from the human in more ways than just as a control signal. So frequently it's used as input to an inference engine, for example. And you can imagine that actually if the signal that you're finally getting has this variability or this noise in it, or if it takes a while to actually be issued and that's characterized for a particular interface, then there's a mismatch between what the autonomy, between the state of the world that generated the intended control signal and the state of the world that the autonomy is perceiving and making a decision on at the time that it receives the control signal. So we did a very basic evaluation of this using just the trajectory following task, where we did a very simple intent inference, where we just did a forward projection of the control command of a half a second, which is actually what we use on our powered wheelchair when we're providing just obstacle avoidance assistance. And we saw what the errors looked like between the forward projected goal or location, and then where the wheelchair actually ended up half a second later. And we saw that there were significant differences there were certainly differences and significant for the uninjured group in the prediction error when you were using different interfaces. So taking this all a step further, we were wondering what would happen if we actually remapped our more able or more our less limited interfaces according to the constraints of our most constrained interface, which is the SIP and PUF. Now, this was just pilot data that we gathered on five lab members, and we presented it in an ICRA workshop, and then also 2 years later, it just shows up in the ICRA paper, in a different ICRA paper. And what we saw was that in response time, so we, with the joystick versus the head array, we initially had, when it's unmapped, the standard mappings, we see a significant difference in response times with a single user or between users using these two interfaces. However, when we remap the joystick to have the same sort of constraints as the SIP and PUF, those differences disappear, or at least their significance disappears. Same thing in terms of for the trajectory following task now, in terms of the percent of the time that they were off of the optimal path. So how many times did you go off or how often did you veer off of the optimal path and to what extent? And in this case, again, we saw that there were significant differences between now both interfaces and the SIP and PUF using the standard mappings, but that these disappeared with the once we remapped the interfaces. So we decided to model all of this explicitly. So typically when we look at task level actions and the map to robot control command, this is kind of just treated, this mapping is treated as a black box. And so I would call this as user interface to be user interface agnostic. What we did in this work was that we actually acknowledged the fact that to issue a control signal through an interface requires physical activation of an interface. Even if the interface isn't directly on you, you need to move if a camera picks it up. Even if it's that it's electrical signals from the brain or the muscles, there's activation that's taking place. And that there can be a mismatch between the intended activation and what actually gets measured through the sensors on the interface. And so what we did in this work was that we actually explicitly modeled this pathway of intended interface command to measured interface command. And how we did that was that we first modeled stochastic deviations in the user input. So we gave users prompts that you're seeing below. And we saw this is just about the activation commands, the actuation of the interface that happens. It's not about what it maps to on the actual robot platform. And we gathered data and built a model for each user. And so what this could mean is, for example, if you were in, so this is now a state chart for what operation of a using a SIP and PUF to operate this simulated 3D robot that we had. This is how the SIP and PUF interface mapped to control within that space. So if you were in state X and you wanted to transition to state Y, you had to issue a hard PUF. If instead that was detected as a soft PUF, then what would happen is that you go forward in state X instead of actually transitioning. The next thing we did was that we actually performed model-based inference of the intended input. So we actually inferred what was their intended action based on the fact that we had inferred first their intended interface activation from the measured interface action activation. And to our knowledge, this is the first work that's performing intent inference at that level, at the level of interface activation. And then we provided customized assistance only if the interface, the intended versus measured interface action didn't match. We evaluated two mechanisms of assistance. We did, this is a preliminary study using 10 uninjured subjects operating this in this simple, simple simulation domain, but they were operating a real sip and puff interface. And what we found was that we had our assistants had the greatest efficacy when people had a noisy map from intended to measured interface, but they still had a good understanding of how the commands, the interface commands map to the robot control. And what's in preparation right now is that we're actually going to, we've relaxed some of the assumptions in this initial formulation, and we're going to evaluate it on real hardware. And that should be starting with, I think, within the month. Okay, so actually I want to bring your attention briefly to that state chart right there. And so actually that state chart was using something that we introduced 5 years ago in this idea of interface-aware planning, where we actually modeled interface-induced constraints within the state and action spaces, the state transition function, and the cost function within a modified planner, a modification of the A-star family of planners that we call C-star. This is what a state machine looks like for a sip and puff interface that's operating a wheelchair. And this is standard. This is what it looks like in the field as well. And what we did was that we actually came up with a hierarchical representation for this, a Harrell chart representation, and we appended the Harrell state to the state space, and also it played a role in the cost function. And so we came up with this way of producing plans that were closer to what humans operating the robot would produce. And we saw that when we looked at the average agreement between the human and the robot command, and the divergence in their paths, or the divergence in the heading of the robot at any given time. And this was pilot data. Okay, and then I think I've been talking way too fast. I'm much further along in the talk than I thought I'd be. So I guess we'll have a lot of time for questions. Stepping back to that original wheelchair study that I presented, we actually saw interface differences at that time as well. And we did publish this, but we didn't quite, I think, give it the weight that we are now. So we, again, as I mentioned, we saw similar performance according to the measures you normally use to evaluate robots, but we did not see similar interface use. And what I mean by that is that for a given control paradigm, or between different control paradigms, for a given interface, operating with different shared control paradigms, the number of interface interactions changed. So actually when the autonomy changes, it's going to change the way that people interact with the interface. Okay, so I'm gonna bring back this chart, right, or this list right now and add to it. But another challenge for assistive autonomy is human understanding of the machine. So the control mappings and kinematics, and also of the autonomy. And that this is a real challenge for when we're trying to build autonomy that's appropriately responsive to a human. So I'm going to mention a work that's been sort of ongoing, but now finally launched off the ground in my lab. This is a collaboration with Sandra Musso-Valdi, who's also at Northwestern in the Shirley Ryan Ability Lab. And this work, it's going to be quite longitudinal, and it involves a custom interface, which is why I'm mentioning it in this talk. But basically, Sandra's lab has been developing what's called a body-machine interface. And the idea is that you put sensors on the body, most commonly IMUs, on the upper body, and you map this down to a lower dimensional control point. And so you kind of turn the upper body into a joystick. And they had always mapped it to a 2D control point, and they had used it to operate a wheelchair. They'd used it to control a cursor on a screen in order to play games of Pong, type on a keyboard, a virtual keyboard, things like that. And what we want to do is use this to control a higher dimensional system, so a robotic arm in particular. And when we were going into this, it wasn't even clear to us that this would be possible. So I can think of like four very clear dimensions. I should mention that our aim is to use this for people with cervical spinal cord injury, which Sandra's group has been doing this for a while. And an advantage to this interface is that they actually have shown that there are some rehabilitation benefits to operating, to performing the sort of movements that are needed to operate this interface. So our motions are limited to kind of just shoulder movements, light shoulder movements. And so if you were to ask me to generate six or seven distinct dimensional shoulder movements without coupling dimensions, it's unclear to me how to do that. Four is very clear. But beyond that, you start to maybe need to couple dimensions and it becomes quite complicated. So our plan with this project is basically to start out by partitioning the control space or having the robotics autonomy step in some sort of way, but basically have it be that the human only needs to control issue a low dimensional control signal. And then over time, we ramp up the human's control signal, the dimensionality of their control signal, with the idea that eventually, ideally, we get rid of the robotics autonomy. And so here it's actually that the robotics autonomy is using robot machine learning in order to elicit human motor learning. So this is the first phase of this study is actually just completed this morning. And so the first phase was we had 10 uninjured participants come in for 5 sessions each. So the 50th session concluded this morning. And we had them performing reaching tasks. We had them performing some functional tasks, and there was no robotics autonomy engaged. So our intent was to gather a baseline of learning without any robotics autonomy, and also to gather information that will help inform the design of our autonomy in terms of adaptation parameters and things like that. So the second phase of the study is on deck, and it's going to be quite a bit more ambitious. This is going to be 20 spinal cord injury participants, and they're each going to come in for 20 sessions. Okay, so the final part of my talk, as I said, I've gone much faster than I expected, so I apologize for that. But in terms of, I wanted to pause or take a final moment to think about what adaptation looks like under assistive autonomy. So within this domain, we know that the person is physically changing, or it's very likely that they're physically changing. So, you know, people always adapt to technology, but when a person is physically changing, that's an additional constraint. So it might be that they're regaining ability due to rehabilitation, they might be losing it due to a degenerative disease. And so being responsive to this is important. It might even just be that day to day or throughout a day, the autonomy needs to be responsive to their pain or fatigue. And so there are some challenges for what adaptation can look like under assistive autonomy. And I'll just give the sort of pointer that this was actually the topic of a plenary talk I gave for ICML last year in 2020. And so I expand upon these ideas quite a bit more in that talk if you're interested. So the first question is where the feedback signal actually comes from for learning. So is this in the form of a reward? Is it a supervised label? Is it a correction? Is it a demonstration? Are we explicit? Is the human explicitly providing it, saying, no, I didn't like that. Yes, I liked it. No, do it like this. Or is it something implicit that, you know, they took over control, and so we take that as an implicit signal that either we stepped in at the wrong time or we stepped in the wrong way. The second is this mask and filtered information. So there's whether or not we're actually capturing the true intent of the human, or whether or not they're able to provide it to us. But there's also this question of whether or not the autonomy can trust the human. So we talk about the inverse a lot within the field of robotics, whether or not humans trust robots. But I would argue that for shared autonomy systems, especially when the autonomy is partly in place to keep the system safe or to compensate for motor deficits in the person, we need to reason about whether or not the signal we're receiving from the human can be trusted. And we've done a little bit of work in that area, but we're continuing to do more. There are also temporal considerations. So there's the physiology of the human, as I just mentioned, their rate of familiarization with the technology, rates of adaptation. So you don't want to adapt too quickly that it becomes unintuitive to them, but you don't want to adapt so slowly that you're not responsive to their needs and their changing needs. And then there's this question of human autonomy co-adaptation. So if the autonomy is adapting to the human and the human is adapting to the autonomy, we now have this evolving target of co-adaptation, and appropriately situating yourself within that is a real challenge. Okay, and that's actually it, because I talked so much faster than intended. So I'd like to thank my lab members, prior on the right and current on the left, and also my my funding institutions and affiliations. And with that, I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Brenna. I would like to invite everyone that has questions to unmute or write in the chat. And I can start. Brenna, you mentioned that when the autonomy changes, it also changes the way how people interface with the technology. So I, from my understanding, you were mentioning that they can use it more times or less times. So maybe frequency usage that is changing according to the autonomy of the system. I was wondering if you could elaborate a little bit on that finding and what it means for the user to consider the system good. So what would be the autonomy level that would be considered ideal and why?
So I can tell, I think probably the best way to answer that is to talk about some factors that I think we should be paying attention to. So I actually didn't talk about it, but we've seen in other work when we actually allowed end users to customize how controlling sharing happens, that actually they didn't necessarily optimize for reduced interactions with the control interface or reduced number of mode switches. They things that we normally would optimize for in robotics, it's not necessarily what's happening. And so I think that, you know, increased number of interactions with the control interface could be interpreted as many different things. It could be interpreted as good things. It could be interpreted as bad things. And I think that the only takeaway I was able to give at this point of our research was just that it's happening. That when we have the same sort of path planner, the 100% autonomy aspect is the same. What's changing is the control sharing. And that manner of control sharing, even though one wasn't really much more aggressive than the other, anything like that, it is still the manner of interaction, the user manner of interaction with the system in issuing controls to the signal system changed.
Thank you. Yeah, I was thinking if that could be a good segue for personalizing those systems, because maybe different people have more, want to have more control and others want to have less control. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah, that was great, Brenna. I was excited to see the finite state machine representation of the SIP-PUF interface because we did some work where basically trying to very formally represent an interface with like the events that change the modes, and even like we didn't realize those modes even existed on a GUI until we were really trying to think about like different versions of the interface. But mm-hmm. then, you know, once we put it into, it became a pretty big finite state machine, we realized like, oh, we could change all of these events to be something else. So we realized all the other versions of the interface that we hadn't even thought about. Mm-hmm. And for instance, some of these were, you know, using a click or basically one thing we heard from one of our users was, clicking and dragging was really hard. So instead having, you know, a press and a release be the events, we had a click and a click be the events, and then in between it would be in a different state, right? Mm-hmm. But basically my question is like, is this, I hadn't seen that in many papers. Is there kind of these formal frameworks for representing interfaces? Is FSM a common one, or have you seen other ones?
I have not. So we just we came up with this representation based on how we know the interface operates from using it, and we also talked to manufacturers. But it's not that we actually have seen it. I mean, for one thing is that, you know, these are I don't know what would be the standard. I mean, finite state machines, I think, are used in industry. I mean, I would expect so, but I don't actually know what is the standard within assistive technology for how they are representing things under the hood. I mean, they're intentionally not transparent about that. So I don't know if it exists on the industry side, but I have not seen it within academia. So we did this model by hand. The Harrell state chart was helpful because we could actually model. It was, I should have spent more time on it, but we actually clustered together states that had required similar activations. So within the SIP and PUF, you can have a latching command and a not latching command. And so when you have a latching command, it's like you have to undo it in order to actually switch to another command. And so we grouped those together and then grouped the other ones that were just sort of like the instantaneous commands, they were grouped together. And then there was actually a cost to switch between the two. But by grouping them together and just appending the Harrell state chart or Harrell state, which there were only two, to our state space representation and actually allowed us to have a more compact cost function.
Yeah, that's another great example of like formally putting it down really helps you clarify the ideas. Yeah.
There is Kat with one question, and then Raphael also has a question on the chat.
I was going to say, if you want to do Raphael's first, or I can read it. It says, with respect to not being able to trust the signals coming from the humans, what are some reasons this might be the case? And then I'll ask my question after that.
So I'd say that the easiest reason when we know that we wouldn't want to trust it is if we were very certain that it was unsafe, right? Now, what is considered unsafe, of course, can scale with different users. You know, when you have more expertise or you're more skill, or if your reaction time is faster, you maybe can get closer to an obstacle and it's not yet considered unsafe. Whether or not you can trust that, like this idea of trust, when it's really about the end user's control, then it's hard to imagine situations that go beyond just safety. But I think for other human robot systems, and when it's a little bit more task driven and less human agency driven, I think that there could then be other reasons as well.
Thank you, Brenna, for the great talk. It's fun to see the updated what you've been working on. I was curious, you know, at the beginning you show like the sensor suites and the AI and computation. And I love like building on what Maya says, how you formalize some of these, you know, inputs and interactions. I was curious, you know, now that there are getting to be more commercialized sensor suites to enable these controls, you know, traditionally it's like, okay, you have your joystick, you have your sip and puff, you have all these inputs that need to be formalized, but now we also have all the inputs from, you know, the sensor suites. How are you thinking about integrating that, you know, all the sensor suite into these formalized frameworks?
Yeah, I mean, I guess, I mean, right now we just treat the sensor input as, right now it's reasoned about only at the level of coming up with an autonomous control command. It's not reasoned about beyond that, but that's an interesting question to think about how it would actually perhaps change our interpretation of the human's control command if we're really thinking about things at the level of the interface and intelligently interpreting the interface command instead of just looking at the resulting control command that it mapped to. And what do we think about that? It's interesting to think about how that will all play out. We have not done any formalization of the sensor space yet.
Yeah, I'm really curious. I think Sam's on the call here too, Sam Burden. My brain isn't quite wrapped around these ideas yet, but thinking how those feedback mechanisms and, you know, how you can integrate that to have both intention and is one that I'm really, really curious about. So.
Yeah, I mean, part of our intention at this phase was actually to abstract away the external world and characterize just the interface and the human and how they interact with the interface. Because obviously there's a lot of intent inference that happens about things that are happening in the external world. And, you know, we do that eventually, but the idea was really like, how do we perform inference of the intended human command, irrespective of what's going on in the outside world, but expanding it to have a broader scope is certainly of interest.
Any additional questions?
Yeah, I had a question about, so you had shown in one of your slides that there's no clear, it's never a best interface and people have different preferences and sometimes these preferences aren't stable over time. And I was wondering if you could talk more about things that drive that and if it's predictable or are there some latent factors in people that show up?
I think that the slide you're thinking about was about the control paradigm, the shared control paradigm. Okay, so you said interface, so you meant shared control paradigm, yeah. Yeah, so that's something that we've been trying to kind of pick away at for a while. So with that data, we did, we did push it into a machine learning model and we did okay. We were based on like measures that we could compute, that we could just observe from the robot in predicting the kind of control interface that, or control paradigm, shared control paradigm that people would like. But I think it's really, I mean, there are, again, I think perhaps the right answer to this question is factors that I think will influence it. Not that we have like a silver bullet in terms of knowing exactly what should be, it should be dependent on, but certainly people's familiarity with the autonomy plays a role, that, you know, more aggressive forms of autonomy are more accepted over time and make people nervous at first. I think that, you know, just reliability, I'm sure, must play a role, that, you know, you're more willing to cede control authority to something that you are confident is going to get done what you want it to get done. I really expect that factors like fatigue and pain will play a role, that you maybe there are times when you physically feel a need to kind of cede some control and take your hand off the interface or however you activate your interface, but that that perhaps if you are feeling up to it, that you actually want to have more control. I could imagine it also being linked to the environment, that, you know, you don't, it could be because of like how much you're able to anticipate how the autonomy would perform, that once you see it kind of perform in a certain environment, you're comfortable with relinquishing some control, or it's maybe an environment that you're not comfortable in yourself because it's so dynamic and then you want to relinquish to the autonomy. I think that, yeah, there's really a lot of factors, and I think we've really just begun to scratch the surface.
Does anyone have more questions?
I have another one. Yeah. No one else. On the work with where kind of you explicitly represented the error that can happen in sort of sensing the input, so the difference between intended input and what ends up in the system. You had kind of these abstracted tasks of, you know, reaching a target and following a trajectory, kind of like something where you would know what the ground truth is, and then you would have people try it so that you can kind of estimate where the error is happening. So I thought, again, that was great, as like we've been also thinking about how we can, in a more general, like task independent way, assess input ability to then maximize, like customize the interface so that we can take best advantage, like be in the right space, the null space or whatever, of like that ability. And I think in HCI, there's a lot of, you know, there's the Fitts law and there's these different types of tasks of like reaching a target of different sizes, different distances, crossing lines, etc. In robotics, like inputs, I have it like, this is the first one that I'm seeing of like a potential set of tasks, but have you thought about like what would be other tasks that are definitely relevant, or have you seen other ones also do these types of
things? Yeah, I haven't seen any other ones. And I will say that actually we released our code, so this is publicly available. But we've certainly been thinking about expanding it to higher dimensional spaces, or we're in the process of doing it, because now that we've started looking at things through sort of an interface aware lens, it's hard to it just seems wrong to not apply it to everything. But in order to do so, you actually need to gather this baseline. For characterizing the interface and characterizing the human, we have to gather this baseline data in order to develop those models. And so we are working on expanding this repertoire to be more appropriate. It was much easier to do with a 2D control interface. It's easy to represent the targets because it's just an oriented arrow. So once we think about in 3D, how do we actually represent the targets? And this is something that we're actively working on.
I think I might have a similar question, but in the more of the task space, I'm wondering if you could just talk a little bit about how you think about achieving goals, like mobility goals, some of the metrics that you've talked about, objective metrics like collisions, number of collisions, or path, you know, maybe directness of the path, or some of these other objectives. But I was just wondering if you could speak a little bit about how you think about this high level, like achieving mobility goals, and if there's ways that we can think about objectifying some of these like really high level goals.
Yeah, it's a good question. And I fear I'm not going to have a great answer, in part because I think that this is something that actually the field of rehab struggles with as well. You know, for as many measures as they have to, like OT measures to evaluate certain sorts of different sorts of strength or reaching or like functional tasks, there's always this question of the measure being too coarse And there's always this question of to what extent it actually translates to ADL functionality. So out in the real world, ADL functionality. And tied to that is actually with often the case with these sort of like rehab robots, but actually in the when it happens with PT as well, especially if you're dealing with some sort of an alteration to like the neural control of the human body, whether or not you can actually use the same error measures, you have the same target is of question, right? So like lots of times for therapy, manipulandum therapy, they do these sort of like targeted reaching and your measure is basically whether how straight of a line it is. And after a stroke, whether or not actually a straight line trajectory is the most efficient way to achieve a certain target is, it's not certain. And it has to do with, it also has to do with like the gravity, trying to compensate for the gravity weighting the arm down. And if you, there's been some studies that if you remove that, then like you have straight line targets. And so it's really not about the ability of like the neural control anymore. It's about like muscles actually just fighting gravity. And so, I think that in the field of robotics or like this sort of field, it's the same sort of challenge where, you know, I can think of high level goals, like you want people to be able to take their wheelchairs everywhere, or you want people to be able to operate their wheelchairs without an assistant, or you want kids with CP to be allowed to take their wheelchairs into school because they're not considered dangerous. And so those are all like great high level goals. And then you can think of really low level goals that like, you know, we don't want to hit things, or we want to, you know, have it be that people say they like our system. But there's a huge gap in between there where, you know, the latter can be measured in the lab and the former can't. It can only be measured out in society. And that's actually the end goal. And I don't have a good proposition for what would be a very concrete computational way to link those two.
Thank you.
I had a bit of a meta question. So you had that ICRA workshop paper, and then 2 years later, the ICRA paper. Is it like, and that was like pilot without the spinal cord injured participants. Yeah. Is that the timeline kind of like actually doing, you know, having like real participants come in and iterate?
So I would say that I'm fine with sharing the fact that the first time we submitted that ICRA paper, it got rejected. And so, partly I think the timeline the timeline from the ICOR paper and then right after the ICOR paper, I mean, obviously the ICOR paper actually happened before it was like published in May of 2019. Then I think it was that summer that Maddie did the remapping, just like the sort of pilot. And then it was the next winter, like in January and February, that they did the study that became the ICRA paper. So it was kind of more of like a 6 month timeline to get like the maths developed and then to actually run the study. And, you know, this is that, you know, it's not the only thing that they're doing. So I think that's pretty standard.
I'm curious, what are like some of the hidden challenges of doing this for real? Like
yeah,
hospital having real people come in.
Yeah. So, I mean, there are just basic logistical challenges, like, you know, your patient or your participant might get admitted to the hospital and then they can't come back for 2 weeks. And so, especially if you're trying to do something longitudinal, and not admitted to our hospital, like admitted to another hospital. And so if you're trying to do something longitudinal, that's a real challenge. If you're trying to do something as longitudinal as like over the course of, you know, a half a year, like we're going to be doing for this study that's about to launch, with spinal cord injury patients, there's actually a very real possibility that some of them will pass away in that time. And so you when you're planning for these studies, you actually take that into account, the attrition that can happen because they're just no longer able to participate in the study. But on a little bit more of a day-to-day practical factor, I mean, they need to get to the hospital. So we're quite lucky in the sense that lots of times they already have reason to be coming. And they lots of times our research participants are people who are very active. If they're not actively receiving therapy anymore, they're actually just actively engaged at the hospital. So we have a whole sort of peer mentor program at the hospital. So they maybe are like real believers in research or believers in like reaching back to their community. And so people like that typically are pretty able to kind of get around town, but it's still non-trivial, right? Like we put in when we're writing our IRBs, like we always reimburse people's travel costs, which can get quite expensive. And we don't really, it's not something we really offer for people without motor impairments, but we do for people with motor impairments. We have to transfer people into our wheelchair, right? So like people who have high spinal cord injury, I mean, they can't get in and out of the wheelchair on their own. So I have people in my lab who are now trained to do this. First, we had therapists doing that, but another advantage we have is that, like, you know, there's just a lift on our floor. And so we can put people into the lift and get them transferred into our wheelchair. There's, you know, people who are in wheelchairs have often sitting tolerances. You have to be very careful about pressure sores. And so you need to build space into your study design where they can recline whenever they need to, or on certain, like on every 15 minutes, they take time to recline. So all of these things, like all of these sorts of factors that, or there are all these sorts of additional factors separate from the fact that, of course, like it's a robot platform in academia, so it doesn't always work. And like your sensors might fail and your software might not be doing what you expect it to do. And like that all still exists, but interfacing with the people has these all of these additional constraints, even with it being much easier for us, I acknowledge, than people who aren't just sitting inside of a hospital.
Very, very insightful.
Let's all thank Brenna for such an amazing presentation and engaging Q&A session. And we'll all see you next week on the next colloquium. Thank you so much.
Thanks everyone for the discussion. I'm actually glad my talk was fast.